It's time to step into the Coming Out Lounge, a cool, safe space to be true to your sexual self, with your host, Rick Clemens. Rick has helped hundreds of people come out of the closet, and now each week he's bringing you cool insights for loving and accepting yourself, boosting your self-confidence, and living a guilt-free, purpose-filled life on the other side of the closet doors. Cuddle up with yourself and get ready for heartwarming coming out stories, ideas for living authentically, and tips for being fully self-expressed. Now here's your host, Coming Out Coach Rick.
Hey, 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 closet dwellers and closet busters. It's time once again for the Coming Out Lounge. I'm your host, Rick Clemens, and we're going to do some big, bold moves today as we explore yet another journey of finally coming out after all these years. And I know for me, two of the questions that haunted me after I did come out of the closet, and they were usually posed by other people, were, well, didn't you know you were gay? And, you know, then wasn't your marriage just a whole big sham to keep protecting yourself? And then you use somebody else. And every time I answer those questions, I got a little bit better at really coming from a space of truth and being really honest. And so I can tell you that those questions haunted me for years, but now I feel really strong in the way that I'm able to answer those questions. And I realized too, as I was answering those questions, that what I thought before was I was the only one going through this, but yet no, there's tons of men and women who go through this. Tons of people who've been in the closet, been married, have kids, have grandchildren, then finally decide it's time that they need to be who they are. And today's guest is one of those people. He's a psychiatrist. His name is Loren Olson, and he brings his own personal story plus his take from being in the psychiatrist chair on what this all looks like when you're going through this, as well as clients that I'm sure he's worked with. And he's got a really beautiful, powerful book. I've had a chance to read quite a bit of it in the last few days as we've been working towards this interview. It's called Finally Out, Letting Go of Being Straight. And I would encourage everyone to get a copy of it who's going through this journey. In fact, we'll have it up on the show page. But rather than me blabbing on here, let's go ahead and bring Loren on to the Coming Out Lounge podcast. Welcome, Loren, and thanks for being with us today.
Thanks, Rick. I've been looking forward to this.
Well, me too, Loren. So let's kind of put some perspective for our listeners. You came out late in life, correct?
Yes. Yes. I was 40 about when I finally made that transition.
Okay. And so 40 years old, married at the time, not married? Where?
I was married, had two kids. And so I had lived a heterosexual life for nearly 40 years at that point.
And at that point, what was really the driver of staying in the closet and staying in that marriage for you?
Well, I think probably one of the biggest considerations was that I had two kids. And, mm-hmm. you know, I'd lost my father when I was very young. And so one of the most important things that I valued was the idea of being a full-time and involved father for my children. And so when I began to sort of uncover the layers of my sexuality, the thought of leaving a marriage and leaving my children behind was pretty devastating to me.
Mm-hmm. And I think that happens for most of us who have been in those shoes. I know for me, it was that. Secondarily, it was, I'm not sure I'm ready to face the music, so to speak, of everybody that, you know, as it got closer, the music of, you know, having lied, having not been truthful and all those sort of things. As you got closer to realizing this was going to be the path, was there an inciting event that you finally just said, okay, I've got to do this? Is there something special that showed up, or you just finally said, I can't live this?
Well, that special thing was a man. Uh-huh. You know, I wasn't expecting it. And I met a man at the gym and I thought it would be a kind of a one-off sexual experience. And I was curious about that. I had not really had anything significant in the way of same-sex experience at that point. And so I entered it with the idea that it would just be a one-off hookup kind of thing. And then I continued to meet him and found myself falling in love with him. Mm-hmm. And in the process of experiencing sex with him, I found that there was a whole dimension of sexuality that I really hadn't explored or discovered before that time.
So I'm curious, in your practice as a psychologist and working with people, had you ever worked with someone who had been in these same shoes as you?
Oh, yes. I mean, I, of course, intellectualized the whole process.
Sure.
and didn't really think it related to me. I have one instance, which is somewhat sad, I think, as I think back on it. But I was seeing a man who was married in my practice, and he was having hookup city, met at truck stops and stuff like that. And I was asking him questions about it. Well, one day he came into my office, and as I turned around from my desk, he was standing in my office naked. And I realized later that, you know, what had happened was that I was asking him more questions than I should have, and that I was there dealing with my own curiosity rather than trying to be helpful to him. And, you know, those were things, of course, that I should have worked out in my own training in psychiatry, but I hadn't. And of course, at the time I was in my training, homosexuality was considered a pathologic deviance, and I probably would have been asked to leave the residency had I brought those things out in supervision. So, I mean, that was just one instance, and sort of embarrassed about it in a way. But as I look back on it, I hadn't really worked through those issues myself as I should have.
So just to kind of put this in perspective, because I think a lot of our listeners, they're from all over the world and all age ranges. So when this was finally unraveling for you, what time frame in our history was it? In the 70s, the 80s, 90s? When was all this starting to really unravel?
I really finally left my wife in 1986.
Okay.
So it's nearly 30 years ago.
Yeah, yeah. So for those listening, this was one of those pivotal kind of arenas in our history, because the AIDS crisis was in full swing. There was still the don't ask, don't tell sort of stuff going on. And we were still in places where, you know, when Loren brings up that, you know, working with someone who was meeting men in truck stops, this was kind of the norm. This was, you hide what you are, you go have these experiences, because if anybody were to find out, you were pretty much, especially if you were religious based, damned to hell, so to speak. And it could be a really scary place for anyone who was admitting that they were gay or lesbian at that point in time, correct?
That's exactly right. You know, and it's very difficult, I think, for young gay men and women to understand what that was really like. But all through my medical training and then I went into the Navy and then into my psychiatric residency, that whole time I didn't know anybody who was openly gay. I mean, that's hard to imagine these days, that you could live to be in your early 30s and not have experienced somebody who lived openly gay. But that was the world that it was. And even the person who testified at the American Psychiatric Association conference when they're considering changing the diagnosis testified with a mask over his face. He was called Dr. Anonymous. It was so threatening that he couldn't reveal his own identity at that time. So yeah, that was the world. And then of course, when I finally made the decision, there was a concern about what am I doing now going into a world where HIV is a big risk. And it seemed slightly crazy. But the other side of it was, Rick, that I felt such intense pressure to resolve this conflict within myself that I had to push ahead regardless of those consequences.
And I think that's what happens for most of us. I mean, I know when I, you know, my coming out was literally about 10 years to the same time frame that yours was, that there had been a little more exposure. You know, there'd been a few more TV shows kind of subtly addressing this issue. But I also had just moved to California when I'd been in back home in California, I guess, for about 6 years when this finally came to fruition for me. And it was a little more embracing environment. But even then, we were still battling all these different societal pressures and, you know, perceptions of what it really meant to be gay and lesbian. And I agree with you 100%. It's really hard for a lot of people today to go, really, I don't understand that. But yet, even as you and I are speaking today, I think there's some very interesting things going on in our current culture that are pointing to those signs that say, yes, but we're still not done. The fight is not over at this point. As you are in your current life and then looking back over what you've been through, what are some of the concerns you have right now that we're facing as a community, as we're facing as individuals, given where the world is, and especially here in the United States? I'd love to get your take.
Well, yes, Rick, I'm very concerned about the current political environment. I wrote in the book about the McCarthy era, which was when I was about 10 years old, and I look back and part of what I did in my book was to say, how could I have not known when I was young? And I wanted to go back and study what life was like for me when I was growing up. And I was probably about 10 years old at that time. And that was a time when they had this big move to purge the government of subversives and homosexuals. And it was, as I look back on it, in many ways, there are parallels to what's going on right now. And I find that rather frightening.
Yeah, I agree 100%. And I think it's one of the things I think you've done such a beautiful job in your book is you've started to bring forward some of the historical stuff so that people can see that. And I say all the time on this podcast and some of the things that I write, we need to really wake up here because we are about to repeat history all over again, which I know history does repeat itself, but I would love to see, so many people, especially our younger generation, the LGBTQ community, really grasp onto this and understand deeply that we've got to be ready. We got to be ready to take those stands. And, the people who, were ahead of us, Stonewall and all that, we may be headed down a very similar path right now. And I think all of us need to be ready to say, no, we do have rights and we do have, very much reason to be exactly who we are, because that's all we are is who we are. And you can't really change that.
That's absolutely right, Rick. It's a frightening time for me. And one of my concerns is that the older generation, I'm 73, almost 74 now. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us have been involved in political activism when we were much younger and are kind of tired of that. But I think those of us who have lived through that need to begin to raise our voices. And it has to begin within the gay community. We have to begin to talk to the younger people in our community to really know what it was like here in this country and to realize that the risk of sliding back to that are pretty considerable right now.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So as a psychiatrist, now that you have truly come and step into your own, what are some of the, I guess, kind of the psychiatrist inside insights that you can say to somebody? And I know we could spend hours doing that, but if you had to drop something on a couple of our listeners about, okay, here's really, truly the psychological bent, the psychological proof that this is just who you are. What would be something you'd give somebody right now that says, I'm going off of something you said that I found really powerful in the book is, as long as I perceive a sexual partner as nothing more than a body part with which I might achieve an impersonal orgasm, it's really hard to see myself as anything more than an instrument of sex. And when I read that, I'm like, yes, that was me. I'm just an instrument of sex. So, okay, I'll just have this sexual thing and it's not really who I am. But that's so, for many people, I think some people just like, yes, I think there are men who just like to have that experience and then they can go on. But I think for many of us, if that's the world we live in, we're being so untruthful and so damaging to ourselves.
Yes, I think, Rick, my first adult sexual experience with a man was when I was about 32. And, I picked out a guy that was he was very stereotypically gay. And we'd never talked about it before. But it's a long story, but the short version is that I ended up going home with him and we had sex a couple of times that night. And it was not very satisfying. It was not much better than masturbating and maybe not as good because, when I masturbate, I wouldn't have that sense of shame going along with everything else. But it kind of tended to reinforce the idea that I really wasn't gay, that this was not the world that I anticipated. And, when I fell in love with this man that I was talking about before, then it began to normalize the whole process and it didn't look shameful anymore. It began to look like a meaningful way of expressing love for another person. And then the shame began to disappear. So I think that's one thing is that when we look at making these kinds of changes in our life, we tend to magnify the negative and minimize the potential gains that come from it. And when you're talking to someone who's in a position of dealing with the conflict about coming out, they can't imagine that sense of peace that comes over you when you begin to integrate the person that you think you are and the person that you want to be.
Right.
And finally, that is such a coming home kind of feeling. But it's hard to tell somebody what that might be like. And coming out comes with a lot of risk and loss. We have to accept that that's the case. But on balance, we need to believe that where we get to is a better place than where we were before.
Well, and I think that's a really important piece of this. I know that was for me that I mean, I lived and breathed that statement. I read, you know, it was just, okay, that's just a sexual thing. But then the kicker, and people who've listened to this podcast over and over again, was truly the moment that I'm like, wait, there's this whole other thing that just happened. We didn't have sex. The guy that finally was the one who pushed me over the edge. We didn't have sex. There was a lot of holding and cuddling and things like that, but there was no real sex. Neither one of us had an orgasm. And it was that connection piece. It was like, oh my God, I actually have this connection to this guy. And it feels similar to the connection I have with my wife, even though the connection with my wife wasn't, it was there, but it wasn't, it was almost like I had this new connection. It's like, this goes so much deeper. And at that point, if we'd had sex, that would have been almost the icing on the cake, so to speak. So I think these are those moments when we step into the truth of, this is what it is, and this is who I am. That's when the light bulbs go off, and that's when we can start to make the shift that takes us forward into the other aspects of really accepting who we are.
I absolutely agree, Rick. You know, when I had that experience, it was like, oh, now I get it. I know what they were talking about all those years before about what it feels like to have that kind of sex, you know, that connection where you're not only connecting intimately in a physical way, but on a much deeper emotional level. And I loved my wife, and I still do, but still there was not that sense of connecting on a intimacy level that was what I experienced with a man. It's hard to describe it, but there was just a sense of kind of a totality of the physical and the emotional all coming together.
So you're very similar to me. We're not that close in age, but we kind of had the same kind of experience. I'm coming up on just another 5 years. I will have lived, you know, God willing, I live another 5 years. I will have lived half of my life being a gay man and half of my life, well, all of my life being a gay man, but half of my life being a truly out gay man and half of my life, you know, being something I wasn't. So what are some of the most powerful lessons you've learned about yourself, you know, basically in both feet in both parts of the water, so to speak? What are some things that you could share there?
I think one of the important things that I've learned as I've gotten older is that I was addicted to approval, that I was always a good boy. I followed the rules. I did everything that I was expected to do. And, you know, some people have more of a sense of rebellion against those values. But what I had to do was to take a look at the value system that I had inherited and begin to deconstruct it and reconstruct a value system that fit in a more valid way with the person that I had become. And I think, you know, I talk some about opportunities of aging, and I think that's something that's very difficult to do when you're younger. But as you get older, you begin to have the power to say, you know, some of these values aren't the ones that I really believe in anymore.
Right.
And I think that was an important transition for me to make that I couldn't probably have made any earlier in my life.
I think that happens for a lot of people. It's very interesting, depending on, you know, how you've been raised, your socialization, you know, where you come from and things such as that. Is I accepted the same thing for myself, as I finally was in a space where I could embrace what I needed to learn and let go of what I needed to let go of. And I came out at 19. I came out in college and my parents said, no, you're not. And we're going to do some, you know, religious counseling and da, 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 da. And I accepted it. I didn't buy into it, but I accepted it because I thought, okay, again, similar to you, I was addicted to approval. And so I let that piece guide me. What I realized, and, you know, for me, and I've said this a couple of times in the past, I'm really glad that that happened, not because of the damage I did to my ex-wife and the hurt that I brought on her, but I'm really glad that I went back in the closet at the time I did, because that was right at the beginning of the AIDS crisis. And it gave me the ability to grow mentally and emotionally into myself to be able to do this when I did. I don't think that if I said, screw you, I'm, you know, staying out of the closet, I don't think I would have done it as well. Not that there was like great hoopla and stuff the way I did it, but it was better. I did it better than I could have when I was at 19, when I was not mature enough to do it.
Yeah, I understand exactly what you're saying there too, Rick, because I had many of the same experiences. And people will often say, oh, don't you regret that you didn't come out at a much younger age? And you know, first of all, I don't regret having married my wife. I don't regret having kids and having that experience. You know, what I do regret is the same thing you were talking about, and that is I regret that it hurt my wife and that was and my kids too. And I never intended to do that. But I, you know, think that as a more mature person, there were certain advantages that I had in that regard. Of course, you know, when we come out in midlife or later, there is a kind of a coming out crash that goes on and, with trying to re-experience all the things that you haven't had. And that can be a bit risky because take chances you might not take otherwise. But once you've worked that out, then I think the maturity is very helpful.
Well, I agree. And, you know, the take chances that can be risky, but I've also worked with clients through my practice where they also sometimes don't take chances and they jump at the first thing that comes along. And then before you see it, they're repeating the same pattern that they had in their previous relationship life. It's like, this person's going to become my everything. This person is the one who, you know, I'm latching on. And so I find it really fascinating to kind of help clients walk, kind of find the balance there. Either you're going to go do really risky stuff or you're going to latch on to the first thing that comes along. It's like, okay, let's find that. Let's go find this. Because for most of us, we didn't get to have our gay youth. You know, we lost that piece. And, you know, I had a client the other day say, I feel like I'm really acting like a stupid teenager. And I said, well, then welcome to your gay life. You're exactly right where you're supposed to be. And I know you're 50 years old, but you're going through your, you know, your gay teen life. And so talk about how you want to do that. You know, that was the next question. So.
I've experienced the same thing that you're talking about with some of my patients and just with talking with people about sort of the magic of falling in love and thinking that that's, you know, you finally found the soulmate. And then after a while, the romance wears off and suddenly you're left with realizing the person that you're with isn't the person that you thought. It's the person that you have created in your mind for them to be. And once the reality of that sets in, there's a disappointment and a chance to then run off and find somebody else who will meet your needs, and then another disappointment. And that pattern can continue for a long time. Relationships are not easy, you know, and we have to recognize that after a year or two that we're left dealing with a real person and not person that we have created.
Well, I think he just said, you just dropped some really beautiful value bombs in like less than a minute. And the one that stuck out to me right out the gate is relationships are not easy. If anybody thinks it's going to be easy, you need to, I mean, this is like a universal truth. But I think what's so interesting, especially, and I'm coming from my own perspective for gay men, I think so many gay men want relationships to be easy. And it's like, hold on, you got two masculine energies showing up here, guys. So let's be real here. This is not going to be easy.
Yeah. A lot of testosterone.
Yes, a lot of testosterone. So I'm curious, you know, through your practice and people that you've worked with, are there a couple of typical patterns? Because I think it's really important for listeners to hear that, they hear the stuff that says, you're not a freak. You're not a weirdo. These are things that people always go through. So we've kind of already addressed, you know, the kid in the candy store sort of mentality, or the immediately, you know, jumping and falling in love with the first person that comes along. Is there any other patterns you've seen people who are coming out that they like, it pretty much always happens for everybody?
I can't say that always. I do think that one common thing is the sense of relief and peace comes, but it doesn't happen to everybody. I mean, I know of a person that I met who decided that he was gay, and he came out to his wife and his kids and all of his friends and associates. And then suddenly things didn't fall in his lap the way that he thought they would. I mean, he didn't find Mr. Right away and realized that there were a lot of disappointments in that. And he got very depressed. You know, I think he thought there was going to be some kind of magic when he did this.
Right.
And when that didn't happen, he got very depressed. And unfortunately, he went to see, well, not unfortunately, but he went to see his minister, and his minister said, well, the problem is that you shouldn't have done this, and you need to remarry your wife, which he did. Now he's living a different kind of unhappiness. But, you know, you said, and we were talking about, it takes work, and you have to work on a relationship for it to happen, and it's not going to fall suddenly out of the sky for you.
Well, and I think you need it. You really, I'm so glad you shared that story, because it is about being real with yourself, that, you know, coming out and this is going to sound rather abrasive maybe to some people, coming out doesn't solve all the problems. There's a whole lot of other stuff that most of us contend with within ourselves besides just the coming out piece. I know for me, once I came out, I also had to start getting real about, wait, I wasn't living a truthful life in this arena, which then showed me there was a pattern of not living truthful lives in other areas of my life, like being in a job that I didn't like and, you know, having in certain friends that I only did because it was that, again, that thing of approval. And I started realizing this. So a lot of what we think is going to happen is we got to like readjust our view of the world. We got to look at the focus and what is that meaning we're putting on things. I don't know that a lot of people, when they come out of the closet, realize this isn't just one area of your life that it affects. It's a holistic thing that you start looking at your lens of life in so many different ways, if you're open to it. I know the reason some people trip and fall is because, well, this was supposed to solve everything for me. And oftentimes that isn't the case.
No, it just solves one piece of it, that's for sure. And, you know, I think one of the nicer parts about getting older is that some of these things tend to fall into place a little bit easier for us. But, you know, I hate the concept of networking. networking is really about what can you do for me? You know, it's not about establishing a connection based on a mutual caring about each other. It's so selfish in the way that we deal with it. And one of the things that I decided when I turned 60 was I'm never going to a cocktail party anymore where I know I'm not going to really like anybody there. You do those things when you're trying to climb the ladder to success, but they suddenly become sort of meaningless. And you think, why am I wasting my time pursuing relationships with people I really don't like? Or, maybe it's not that we dislike them so much as we don't really care that much about them. So it is, I think, a broader coming out in a way of accepting that we have a different way of looking at the world altogether.
Well, and I think also what you just said is really valuable, that when we start to ask this one question, what are we coming out? You know, we're coming out in our sexual orientation, but then what else do we need to come out about? What else do we need to get really real with ourselves about? And I always advocate that coming out is one of the most powerful spiritual experiences that one can have with oneself, but don't just say, okay, that was that beautiful spiritual experience. What else has this shown me? What else has this told me and encouraged me that I need to go be really real in this other arena of my life too? And it's amazing. And I know you've seen this as well as I have, that, you know, people will come out and then other things start to, like, you know, they either lose a ton of weight or they suddenly start pursuing something that's really a passion that they're like, wow, I really wanted to do this. And it's like the coming out is like learning how to give yourself permission. And if you really dive in and fully embrace the power of this coming out, you start to give yourself permission in a lot of other areas to be who you really are and who you've always been.
Yeah, I certainly agree. I was thinking about, you're talking about the weight loss. And, you know, people who do that also have the expectation that now everything is solved. I'm thin again.
Right.
And, you know, after a while, everybody who's noticed your weight loss, and there aren't new people to say, my gosh, you look great, you lost weight.
Right.
And then that reinforcement has diminished, and you're left with the same world that you started with. You know?
Absolutely.
But it goes back to the issue of sort of the being too dependent on approval. And as long as we have put other people in charge of our lives by seeking their approval, we aren't in charge of our own life. We've handed over control to those people that from whom we're seeking approval. And we need to take that back and to recognize that it is very much like an addiction where you get a hit of approval and it doesn't last long. So you go after another one and after another one and after another one, but you've lost control of your own sense of self.
Absolutely. And I think that's the important piece, is realizing the loss of self started with the whole hiding yourself in the closet to begin with. So as you learn to realize that was a loss of myself that I was doing that, then you can ask the questions, where else in life am I losing myself and not showing up? So I'm curious about the book. What was, you know, I hate to even ask this because this is such a typical, let's ask the author the question, but what got you like inspired, like truly, okay, I've got to write this? What was the impetus for you?
Well, really, I think what started the process was asking myself the question, how could I not know I was gay? And I wanted to try and understand that better. And so it began by looking at sort of the historical aspects and going back and recapturing the life that I was living when I was a child, and then began to get more into the area of the psychological explanations for some of those things. And then in the process of doing that, I met so many other people that had been through that same emotional pain that we were talking about, you know, where you're living with this terrible sense of dysphoria that goes on, this disconnection from who you are and who you want to be. And the risks of suicide for people in that are very high. And here's a story from a man that I met after I spoke to a group. And, you know, he said, none of my friends here know this story about me, but I was married and I had a child. And that my wife and my child were killed in an auto accident. And I know what I should have felt, but what I felt was relief. Mm-hmm. And those of us who have been through that understand what he's talking about, you know, that need to be free of that terrible pain when you feel that you're in a situation, right, there's no way out. And even though he loved his child and his wife, it was torture to be trapped in a situation where it felt like there was no good outcome. There's only two choices and both of them are bad, you know.
Right.
And suddenly the decision was kind of made for him, which gave him some relief. And I remember feeling, you know, that same kind of thing about there's no way out, you know. There's, mm-hmm. And of course, I wanted to escape it with my self-esteem intact, you know. If someone else could solve this problem for me, so I don't have to blame myself.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of it came through the sense of I need to take responsibility for this decision, and mm-hmm. I need to accept that people are going to be hurt, and it's my responsibility for hurting them.
Yeah.
And once I got past that, I think it was easier for me to do it. It was not like I need to blame somebody else for this situation. I can take mm-hmm. responsibility and say, this is my choice to do, and I will deal with the consequences.
You know, and I think it's interesting that you bring up that is the choice to take responsibility. And I know, I'm sure you've encountered this too, that some people who see quote unquote what we did, that we don't take responsibility. And I always try to keep myself in check when I have somebody accuse me of that. And I said, well, I think the greatest responsibility that I did take was to finally come out and admit this no longer works. And that's a huge piece of responsibility there. And to stand in my own personal power and do the best that I could through the journey that then followed after I came out of the closet. Now, I will admit, I wasn't perfect. And I will admit, I know a lot of people who do come out of the closet after being married, and they aren't the most wonderful people when they do it. They get the fuck you attitude, and they're like, now it's my turn to live, and da-da-da. But the thing is each person's going to do their journey their way. And I don't know, your book is definitely needed. I'm so glad to see it, because I can tell you, and I'm sure when you were going through this, when I was going through this in the mid-90s, I looked high and low for support for somebody in my shoes. Books,
absolutely,
groups, and there was very little. And I know Amity Buxton, you know, you interacted with her book, The Other Side of the Closet Door, was about one of three or four out there that even addressed this issue. And it was coming more from the spouse side of it. So I'm so glad to see your book. In fact, when I saw it last year, I think yours came out before mine did. And I thought, yes, now there's kind of a 1-2 punch. There's more of us putting these kind of books out. And what I also find in this day and age, which frustrates me a little bit, is there's still not as many support groups, even within our own community, to support the older person coming out late in life. So I'm just thrilled to see this book out there in the world, Loren, and your voice and the way you approached it is being available to everyone to learn from.
Well, thanks, Rick. That's high praise.
So if you could leave a bit of, like, just a little, you've given tons of knowledge already, but if you could leave like one tidbit of, you know, just advice for somebody who's listening to this, who may be standing in those same exact shoes that you and I stood in debating what they should do, what would you, you know, and I know we're both in the work where, well, we don't really give advice, we guide people, but, you know, I think it's a beautiful time to say, here's some advice I'd really like to give you. What would that be?
Don't give up hope. You know, each of our lives are going to have times when we feel a lot of pain, but we don't have to sit there. We have an opportunity to deal with that pain and not continue the suffering, which is something which is optional.
Yes. You took the words right out of my mouth as you were saying that. I'm like, well, I'm going to say pain is inevitable, but suffering is optional. And you did it for me there. So
that's awesome. That's exactly right.
So if somebody wants to connect with you, why don't you shout out your website real quick before we wrap it up?
The easiest way to do it is to go to finallyouttips.com. And there's some information there about sexuality for men across the lifespan and how it changes and actually can improve over the lifespan. That'll take you to my website and to the information.
We will have that up as well as Loren's website, some Facebook links, get his book directly and all that great stuff. And I just want to say again, Loren, thanks for carving out time to share of yourself, tell your story, and being a beautiful voice of the world that really encourages people to embrace whenever it is that you finally are out. You can live your life and be who you're truly meant to be. So I appreciate you being with us today, man.
Thanks, Rick. I'm glad to do it.
And for those of you that are listening, like I said, we're going to have everything available to connect with Loren. And I also want to encourage you to never stop stepping out, stepping up, and stepping in to living your life your way, taking those simple steps to live big, bold lives, and always being true to yourself. Until next time, it's Rick Clemons, the Coming Out Coach, and we'll catch you in just a few days, everyone. Take care. Hey, 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 closet dwellers and Coming Out Lounge listeners, I wanted to invite you to check something out. You know, for all the years that I've been a Coming Out Coach, one thing I've learned is sometimes people come to do the work with me and they only need a little bit of help to get over something very particular and very important to them. It could be reconciling their religion and sexuality. Maybe it's learning how to have the difficult conversations where they say, I'm gay. Possibly it could be, oh my God, I'm out of the closet, but now how do I do this same-sex dating and mating sort of thing? Well, what I can tell you is throughout the years, there are common things that show up over and over and over again. And what I've heard most from my clients and listeners of the podcast is, I want a way to work with you just on these particular subjects. Yay, I am so excited because I've taken the action and I've made this possible. So how do you find out about these particular programs? You go to thecomingoutcoach.com, or if you're on the show page right now listening to the podcast or have just listened to the podcast, over to the right-hand side of the podcast description area thing is an icon that says one-on-one coaching sessions. Click on that button. You'll be taken to a page that describes each of the different 9 sessions I'm offering. They are one-on-one sessions that we can do via phone, Skype, or even FaceTime. They're very action-oriented. We go right to the topic that you want to talk about. And each of these sessions also includes a copy of my book, Frankly, My Dear, I'm Gay. So what more could you ask for? You get me for 90 minutes devoted to you, plus my book. So go check it out. See if there's something that could help you as you step out, step up, and step in to living your powerful truth. Take care. I'm Rick Clemons, the Coming Out Coach. I look forward to working with you.
You've just experienced the Coming Out Lounge. Go online to www.comingoutlounge.com to learn more. And tune in again next week for more stories and tips for being true to yourself.